Today's topic, we're going to talk about Saint Augustine. He was known as the most important thinker in the church history. In fact, he was like one of the most important thinker in the Western civilization. He became the bridge between the Antiquity time and the Middle Ages time. He was just right there in the middle, in the between of a two big chapters of a history. He was known for his huge collection of works. Of course, I cannot cover it all because otherwise this video will end up for hours. One of the things that probably you heard about, his idea about original sin and free will. He also provided an explanation of the human heart condition like this. You know, you're not supposed to do it, but then again, you do it anyway. And then you know that you should do something, you do something about it, but then again, you decided not to do it. Okay, what I'm trying to say, he formulate the struggle of the human heart about the will to do good and the struggle and then to do good, I mean the will to do good, but then again, it's as we know it, as we are aware and as we are being honest about it, it's not that easy. You know that you have to read your book, but then again, the temptation of you playing video game is also as just as stronger or sometimes even stronger than the will of you to preparing to read the book. Now, Augustine was born in the city of Tagaste. Now, Tagaste is in North Africa. Yes, now. Therefore, Augustine, he is an African. He described himself as the Carthaginians. If you remember, Carthage is part of the Roman Empire at this moment. But long ago, during the Punic War, the Romans conquered Carthage and then, like, you know, claiming the North Africa as part of the province. Augustine's father is someone by the name of Patricius, or sometimes is being Romanized as a patriot. He was a Roman pagan. He was a low-ranked Roman official. Augustine's mother is someone by the name of Monica. And Monica, she's a devoted Christian that always insisting on Augustine's about Christianity. And she will do anything to chase Augustine and making sure Augustine will commit his life to Jesus. Now, Augustine, he grew up as a rebellious child, yet Augustine, he was a very brilliant child. He loved to read. Augustine, he was also known for very rebellious. He spent most of his youth time as being a bully, as being a troublemaker. He was involved into kind of like sinful lifestyle. That is the way that he described his life as a youth in his biography by the title of Confession. Well, Tagaste is a small town, and then for Augustine to get a better education, his mom and dad do everything to send Augustine to the best school that they can send. Augustine, fortunately, he was a very kind of talented and very brilliant student. He studied rhetoric. Now, rhetoric is a very prestigious discipline at the time. In a nutshell, studying rhetoric is basically you learn how to speak persuasively, you learn how to speak eloquently, which is, it was a very important skill and a very important knowledge in the Roman world. In Augustine's sinfulness and his lifestyle, he secretly married with a woman, and then he had a son from this woman, and then he named the son by the name of Adeodatus, which is, the translation means like, you know, given by God. Not just that one, Augustine, he did something that probably his mother will be very, very upset. Augustine decided to abandon his faith as a Christian. He decided to embrace another religion / philosophy known as the Manichaeism. Manichaeism is a kind of a mixture, kind of a belief that basically in a nutshell, okay, Manichaeism believed that about duality of the reality itself. I mean, duality of the world. What does that mean? It means in a nutshell, goes like this. There is this kind of like eternal struggle between the good and evil, the good versus evil, and then it just become like a balance. Probably, if I may borrow this kind of like symbol, but this is not a symbol of the Manichaeism, okay? I'm gonna put it the symbol over here. This is kind of like represent, this is probably close enough to represent like what is Manichaeism all about. There's this kind of like constant struggle in the universe, in the cosmos itself, between the good and the evil. And then human existence and then reality exist in between, trapped in between the constant battle between the good and the evil. Another kind of like philosophy that they had is anything that is good is spiritual, anything that is evil is material or physical. Anything that is good is light, and anything that is evil is darkness. The reality of the world, the reality of humanity are in between. After a while, Augustine, he graduated from the school, and then he became like the teachers of rhetoric, and he was a good rhetoric teacher. Yet he realized that he had a better chance if he moved to a bigger city than Carthage, which is Rome. Of course, this decision of moving Rome is highly opposed by his mother, and then his mother plead to him, his mother pray that somehow God will intervene with Augustine's idea to move to Rome. Why is that? Because his mother knew that his son would be completely lost in a pagan culture predominant city as Rome. So off he go to Rome and then to find a job. In fact, what happens next is for a period of time, Augustine end up, he live in misery, living in the insula, living in the cheapest room that he can rent in insula. During the winter, it's going to be cold. During the summer, it's going to be hot. And then if it's raining, then the roof will leaks. And then the stinks is bad. And then like it's very tiring because you need to walk up and down through the stairs because the cheapest room that you can rent from a Roman insula is the top. Okay, the top floor. Not the top floor, but then again, the top stories. After living in misery for several years in Rome, finally, there was this better opportunity for him to be as a rhetoric professor. Yes, rhetoric professor. He was being recruited as a professor of rhetoric in Milan. A little bit background about it. Now, at this moment, the city of Milan became the administrative center for the Roman Empire. Apparently, Rome itself, even though it was a capital of the Western Roman Empire, but in fact, the emperor no longer live in Rome because Rome is just like overcrowded and it can no longer be a feasible place to be the central government. So the central government of the Western Roman Empire moved to Milan. It was in Milan that the life of Augustine seems to be so much better. He got a huge villa, he got a good paying job, and then he decided to invite his mother and also his friends to live together in a huge villa that he had in Milan. So life is good. At this moment, Augustine, he realized that he no longer believed in the Manichaeism because he found out there's something flaw about the teaching of the Manichaeism that it kind of like, you know, it disturbed him. It kind of like, you know, it doesn't make sense according to him. Now, kind of like, you know, pull you back a little bit. Augustine, since he was a kid, he always struggled with this kind of like idea, and the thought goes like this. I know this is the good thing and I have to do the good thing, but however, there's this exact opposite drive within myself preventing me to do good. Sounds familiar? As I said earlier in the beginning of this video, you know that you have to study well because tomorrow there's an exam, but yet there's also like equally or maybe sometimes stronger desire for you not to study, but then again instead you're playing video games. Now Augustine, he struggled with this kind of like, you know, idea, with this thought for many years. He thought he would find an answer from Manichaeism. In fact, he could not. I mean, in fact, he was disappointed. So now he became like the believer of Neoplatonism. Now Augustine with his profession, new job as the professor of rhetoric, one day he stumbled upon this a very good eloquent pastor, someone by the name of Ambrose, Bishop Ambrose of Milan. His mother tried to convince him to attend the service, and then reluctantly Augustine, he ended up like, you know, listening to Ambrose. Now at first Augustine listening to Ambrose for his great rhetoric skill. Augustine, he was attracted with Ambrose rhetoric speech. I mean, he was attracted with his very eloquent sermon. Over the times, eventually Augustine, His heart start to become receptive towards the word of God that is being delivered by Ambrose. Now there was this iconic moment that happens in Augustine's life. One day he read a book about Saint Anthony written by Athanasius. Yes, Athanasius, he was the champion of the orthodoxy. You might want to check the video that I made about Nicene Creed. I mentioned about Athanasius over there in this video. Go ahead. After he read this book about Saint Anthony, now Saint Anthony, he was a Christian, he was a devoted Christian, that he practiced asceticism. Now, reading this, Augustine, he started to realize and he started to feel sad about his heart condition. As I said earlier, Augustine always struggled in his heart about he's always struggled with this kind of like this truth, this too strong will inside of his heart. He knew that he should stop sinning, but he could not stop sinning. He loves it. In his biography, Confession, he described it like this: God, make me pure and holy, but not yet. Now, what does that mean? It's an expression that he loved it. He loved to be sinful. He loved the sin, but he knew it's wrong, and he wants to stop it, but he cannot. Sounds familiar? So, iconic moment that happened in Augustine's life. So one day, as he was troubled, as he was depressed about this kind of like thought, he was in the garden at a time. He was in the garden in the morning at a time. One of the neighbor's daughter just kind of like casually playing around, singing a Latin nursery rhymes, perhaps, tole lege, tole lege. What does that mean? It's a Latin expression, literally means take it and read it. Take it and read it. Now, when Augustine heard it, he interpreted like this is the voice that God sent to him indirectly through that, the daughter of his neighbor. So immediately he grabbed the Bible and then he opened Romans chapter 13, and then when he read it, he had his heart being transformed and he decided to believe in Jesus. So soon, together with his son, Adeodatus, he asked Bishop Ambrose, that he likes to listen to his sermon, decided to be baptized. And of course, and this is the great news for Monica, his mother, because why? His mother Monica has been praying for his son's conversion for many years. It was like the happiest day ever for Monica as the mother of Augustine. However, 2 years later, the city of Milan, he was about to be overrun by the barbarians invaders. So Augustine and his family together, they decided to go back to Africa, return to Africa, to Tagaste. But somewhere along the way, Augustine's mom, Monica, she passed away. She fell ill and then she passed away. And Augustine was very sad. Once that he arrived in Tagaste, what Augustine did was he sold the house, he sold his inheritance, and then he gave it to the poor. And he decided to live in a small town, living together with his son and with also some other fellow believers, with other some fellow Christians, living ascetic lifestyle. Like, what does it mean? He tried to imitate the example of Saint Anthony, trying to detaching himself from the worldly distractions. That's what he did. But not long after that, another sad news happened to Augustine. His son, Adeodatus, died. So, one day, Augustine, he traveled to a city by the name of Hippo. There's no hippopotamus there, I checked. I'm just kidding. I don't know like what they name it, Hippo. One day, Augustine, he traveled to the city of Hippo for a holiday trip. When he traveled to the city of Hippo, he attending one of the church, and then in that church, the bishop was a very old man. And then at that moment, the bishop was preaching about looking for someone to replace him as a bishop. Apparently, the congregations like recognize who is Augustine, and then they promote Augustine to become the bishop. Of course, he was reluctantly to accept that position. I can imagine that probably he was like, no, not me. But then again, the congregation kind of like, you know, drag him and kind of like force him to become like the bishop. And then finally, he agreed. He became the bishop of the city of Hippo, which is, he dedicated his life as a pastor, as a bishop in Hippo for the rest of his life. That is the reason like why Augustine's title, I mean Augustine's, is also known as the Augustine of Hippo, because he dedicated most of his lifetime in the city of Hippo. Now, probably as I mentioned it earlier in this part of the video, Augustine left a huge collection of work of his thought. I'm not going to be able to cover them all, but probably I'm going to mention the two of them, okay? First is he wrote a biography about himself by the title Confession. This is a very unique and first of its kind biography. Now, biography was not a new thing during the ancient time. Many people, for example, like Julius, wrote biography. Only the difference is Augustine was very, very honest about his life. He even put the embarrassing moment that happens in his life. He described his vulnerability, his struggle with the sin, his struggle with the addiction of the sin, and then his journey from that sinful lifestyle into the godly life. You will not be able to find that kind of biography from the people before him, like Julius Caesar, for example. Julius Caesar was not going to write the most vulnerable moment about him. Now, the second work that he left is The City of God. Now, The City of God is a very important book for the Western civilization. So if I have to give you guys conclusions about it, to be honest, I'm going to show you guys something. Yes, this is the book. I got this copy. However, this is so thick. To be honest, I just started, and then, like, you know, I just started, and I probably, this is my bookmark. I only read this part, only this, woo! I only read this much. And yes, it's lots of pages. To be honest, this is like the thickest book that I attempt to read, and I haven't finished it yet. I cannot give you guys the conclusion, but of course, internet can be your best friend. This is the conclusion of The City of God. This is the conclusion. The conclusion is there is this two reality in this world, the City of God and the City of Man. Now, what does that mean? Those who belong to the City of Man, those who belong and then proclaim that they're living in the City of Man, those who belong to the City of Man will have a tendency to always rebel against God. And eventually, by the end of time, this reality that the City of God will win over the City of Man. And then this book also concludes that everyone who belongs, everyone who subscribes into the City of Man will find themselves empty, will find themselves being unhappy. No matter how they tried, it's a failure. It's always a failure to achieve happiness and justice and all of the good things. Because why? The true goodness, the true justice, the true joy, the true peace can be only found in the City of God when we proclaim that Jesus is the King of the City of God. Now, here's the thing. Which city do you belong to? Choose your citizenship wisely. If you like this video, don't forget to like. And then every week I'm going to make a new videos. Don't forget to subscribe for the notifications. And I see you guys next time. God bless you. Bye-bye.